Thank you for watching this short presentation titled Building E-Learning Modules with Free Web 2.0 Services. My name is Michael Tam, a general practitioner and lecturer in primary care at the School of Public Health and Community Medicine at the University of New South Wales. My co-author is Dr. Anne Eastwood, a regional education director and medical educator at GP Synergy. GP Synergy is a provider of vocational general practice education and training in Sydney, Australia. This presentation was first given at the AME 2012 conference in Lyon, France, and later at the GP12 conference in the Gold Coast, Australia. In this presentation, I'm going to focus mainly on the methods, specifically of how we synergistically used a number of free Web 2.0 services to build and deliver an e-learning course. But firstly, I'm going to take a step back and describe the context. I remember when I first started medical school in the 90s, the World Wide Web was still new and completely uncharted territory. Google didn't exist. By the time I graduated from medicine, which was only a decade ago, not everyone had an email address, and Facebook was still 2 years from launch. Developing e-learning materials is now unavoidable for a medical educator. However, my training, like most other medical educators, does not include web-based technologies. In 2011, Anne Eastwood and I were tasked with developing a short evidence-based medicine and critical appraisal course for GP registrars, that is, GP vocational trainees. The course had to cater to learners with varying baseline knowledge in EVM, and these were learners in the community. It was hoped that this course would help supplement and make more useful the existing face-to-face workshop. It was believed that online e-learning modules that the registrars could complete at their own pace prior to the workshop would be the best way to deliver this learning. When we were designing the course from a conceptual point of view, we were able to address the situational factors, learning goals, and learning activities without much difficulty. However, implementing that conceptual vision into a real and usable product was far from trivial. In our situation, we didn't have ready access to an IT specialist or an educational technologist on our team. Initially, we had a look at Moodle as a learning management system, including installing it onto a private server for testing. Although this was comprehensive and feature-rich, it really did more than what we needed. The administrative burden was heavy and it was a complex system to use. I was also keen that the product would have a pleasing design, and I'm not sure Moodle delivers on that front. This is an example of a free online course that is available on Moodle. Curiously, for a course that teaches teachers about Web 2.0, the interface is clunky and the style dated. This doesn't look too different from the first website I built almost 15 years ago. What we needed was a platform that was firstly easy to use for learners. Moreover, content creation and building the learning activities had to be easy for medical educators with only limited web and technical expertise. Lastly, it was preferable that it could be delivered at low cost, as we didn't specifically have a budget for this project. That really got us thinking about using Web 2.0 services, not from the point of view of sharing per se, but about ease of delivering user-generated content. When you think about Facebook, what it does is really quite amazing. It allows someone with almost no knowledge of web programming to build a complex interactive website. Why couldn't we harness these technologies for delivering e-learning? After much testing of various services, we integrated these following free services. We used YouTube for video narration, Google Docs was used to store and view documents, TinyCC was used to shorten web addresses. We used Prezi to build the e-learning modules as it could tie everything together and then embedded the Prezi module onto a website run through WordPress. Let's go through this in detail. Here I'm going to demonstrate the use of Prezi. So here I'm going to create a new Prezi. I've loaded up my account, demonstration. Everything is based on a web-based interface. There's no software you need to download. Here I've opened a new blank Prezi. If I wanted to upload an image, in here I've put in the GP Synergy logo, you just insert it. If you want to move it around, you just drag and drop. If you wanted to increase or decrease the size, or even rotation, extraordinarily difficult if you want just to do this in HTML. And if you want to add text around an image, again, very simple. It's just type, drag and drop where you want to put it. There we go. And here I've zoomed out a bit. Let's say I want to add some more content, a little bit to the top and to the right. There we are. And how it works is, firstly, you create a view. So what I've done is I'm going to put a frame around the first area. So that's what the first view is going to be. Put a frame around the second view. Using the path tool, add the two paths. So here, basically, it's like two slides. And if we were to view it, it goes from one to the other. Very simple. Next, I'm going to demonstrate the use of YouTube and how to use it inside Prezi. We used YouTube so that there would be video narration in our e-learning modules, so that the learners didn't have to do as much reading. What you might not know is that with a webcam, you can directly record video through a browser interface, have it uploaded and hosted on YouTube, and do some simple editing with no external software at all. So here we go. If you look on YouTube, there's an option on the right, record from webcam. This is a little recording I did of myself recording myself using my laptop with a webcam. Record. This is a live recording of myself, just a few seconds. Stop. And if you can see, I can preview it. And there we go, it's been recorded. Next, I'm going to show how to embed into Prezi. So this is the video I just did. Go into settings, find the URL for the YouTube video. Back in Prezi, that this is the presentation we were working on before, you can insert a YouTube video. Paste the link, insert, there we are, move it to where you want. Here I'm going to add an extra path to the YouTube video. And when we play the demonstration, here we go, second view, third view, video is playing. There we are, video inserted into the module, no software required. The main advantage with using Google Docs to host documents like Word files or PDFs is that it can be viewed directly through the browser. If the registrar is using a clinic computer to access the module, it may not have the necessary software installed, and they may not be able to download files. Here I'm going to give an example of one of the files hosted. Here's the URL. Click, it opens up. And as you can see, the document, a PDF in this case, is loaded up directly in the browser without needing any plugins. Shortening and simplifying web addresses reduces the likelihood that learners will type in the wrong address and enhances usability. For example, compare the web address on top to the bottom. TinyCC also allows for some customization of the shortened address to make it meaningful. As you can see on the bottom, the URL for our course is tiny.cc/ebm4gp. WordPress is a blogging platform and suited our needs well. Here I've loaded up our page on WordPress. Let's say I wanted to edit one of the pages. You can edit it pretty much just like using a word processor, all the usual sort of things, bold, italics, headings. Let's say I wanted to add an extra link to that module. You just type it in, nice and simple. The result is that we're able to build 5 multimedia-rich tutorial-like e-learning modules, and we did this with no assistance from an IT consultant. We didn't need any specialized software. Most of the work was done through a browser interface. The modules can be accessed by learners anywhere with a modern web browser. I'm going to give just a short demonstration on the actual site. Now, this is the main homepage. I'm going to click on Module 4. There we go. It's loading up. As you can see, the module has a Prezi embedded module at the top, and that's where the main learning activities are, some references and optional readings at the bottom. And to start to access the learning module, you hit the forward button. And now, there we go. I give a short introductory video, and in the real live version, you can hear me speaking, though in this presentation, the sound's been turned off. And within this module, it goes around in a clockwise fashion. So here we've got a section on p-values and confidence intervals, external validity. And each module takes around 45 minutes to complete. Now, there are some limitations with the methods we've described. Compared to a full learning management system, you don't have features like messaging between learners, and we couldn't smoothly integrate an online worksheet. In our course, learners complete a paper worksheet as they progress through. With the data hosted on the cloud, there are potential data security issues. If a service goes down, then the data may be lost. Also, by avoiding users needing to have logins for each individual service to improve usability, there is a possibility of individuals who are not the intended learners accessing the learning modules. This may or may not be an issue. There may be intellectual property implications, particularly for institutions that have a restrictive default policy. In conclusion, our experience demonstrates that modern Web 2.0 services remove many of the technical barriers to creating and sharing content on the internet, and that includes e-learning content. They were a pragmatic solution for our particular context. When used synergistically, Web 2.0 services can be a flexible and low-cost platform for building e-learning activities. Thank you for watching our presentation. If you have any questions, comments, or queries, please don't hesitate to contact me by email at m.tam@unsw.edu.au. Thanks again.